We'll start, inshallah, brother. أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم إن الحمد لله نحمده ونستعين به ونستغفره ونؤمن به ونتوكل عليه ونعوذ بالله تعالى من شرور أنفسنا ومن سيئات أعمالنا من يهده الله فلا مضل له ومن يضلل فلا هادي له ولن تجد له وليا مرشدا وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له خلق فسوى وقدر فهدى وأشهد أن محمدًا عبده ورسوله وصفيه من خلقه وحبيبه بلغ الرسالة وأدى الأمانة ونصح للأمة فكشف الله به الغمة وجاهد في سبيل ربه حق جهاده حتى أتاه اليقين وتركنا على المحجة البيضاء ليلها كنهارها لا يزيغ عنها إلا هالك يا أيها الذين آمنوا اتقوا الله حق تقاته ولا تموتن إلا وأنتم مسلمون يا أيها الناس اتقوا ربكم الذي خلقكم من نفس واحدة وخلق منها زوجها وبث منهما رجالا كثيرا ونساء واتقوا الله الذي تساءلون به والأرحام إن الله كان عليكم رقيبا يا أيها الذين آمنوا اتقوا الله وقولوا قولا سديدا يصلح لكم أعمالكم ويغفر لكم ذنوبكم ومن يطع الله ورسوله فقد فاز فوزا عظيما أما بعد فإن أصدق الحديث كتاب الله وأحسن الهدي هدي محمد صلى الله عليه وعلى آله وصحبه وسلم وشر الأمور محدثاتها وكل محدثة بدعة وكل بدعة ضلالة وكل ضلالة في النار اللهم صل وسلم وبارك على نبيك وحبيبك ورسولك محمد صلى الله عليه وعلى آله وصحبه وسلم أما بعد All praises due to Allah May the peace and blessing of Allah be upon His Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. I bear witness that there is no one worthy of worship but Allah alone without any partners. And I bear witness that Muhammad, peace be upon him, is the messenger and prophet of Allah. Brothers and sisters in Islam, assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. Dear students of Sharia Academy, may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala reward you for coming today. And may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala make you among those about whom our beloved messenger Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam said man salaka tariqan yaltamisu bihi ilma sahala Allahu lahu bihi tariqan ila al-jannah aw salaka Allahu bihi tariqan ila al-jannah aw kama qala sallallahu alayhi wasallam may Allah make all of us among those whom Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam spoke about by saying whoever start a path for seeking knowledge Allah will start their path to jannah inshallah So I want you to have that understanding or that meaning always present in your mind through very long, strenuous course, long time, and those hours. You have that meaning with you, it will rejuvenate all those, your ability and your health and all that. So you are starting your path to Jannah, inshallah, with the blessing of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Our lecture today, or our seminar, that this is the first lecture of is about the Ulum al-Qur'an, the subject of Ulum al-Qur'an, the sciences of Qur'an. And as important as the definitions are, we'll start with the definition, what the word science means, what the Qur'an means. And then by understanding this definition, we will know what are the components, of Ulum al-Qur'an. And the importance of studying Ulum al-Qur'an in general and the importance of studying each of those branches in particular. This is very important. And since we are a university level student, so I'm expecting your undivided attention because this is a fundamental subject. It is not a secondary subject or it is not a practical subject that you the rules applied in already. No, those are the rules by which it will help you to understand the tafsir, help you understand anything relating to the Qur'an. So it is more of rules, but I'll try my best, inshallah, to make it interesting. Because studying the usul of anything, always it's a tough thing to do. Studying usul al-fiqh, it is a tough thing to do. But it is easy to study fiqh. Studying fiqh is not easy, but in comparison to studying usul al-fiqh, it is simple. And it's not necessary for someone to know usul al-fiqh to know fiqh. It's not necessary. But whoever possesses the usul al-fiqh, fiqh study becomes something very simple and enjoyable. They enjoy studying the fiqh once they know the usul. Same thing when you know Ulum al-Quran and the usul of this beautiful, honorable branch of knowledge, it will make the tafsir different to you. You will start looking at things differently. When you read the tafsir of a surah or of an ayah, you know what does it mean, or how important it is to know the history behind that ayah. How we understand that ayah. This is called asbab al-nuzul, for example, the reason of revelation. And this is one of the sciences of Quran, is the knowledge of asbab al-nuzul, which we will have one lecture for it. The reason of the revelation of the verse. Is it a person? The person was the reason of that revelation? Or it's an incident? Is the reason of revelation is multiple reasons? Multiple reasons for the same verse? Or few verses share the same reason? How this work? So when you read these ayat, after you know this, it becomes different. You listen to them in a different way. You understand them in a different way. You enjoy them in a different way. Knowing another science, which is al-nasikh wal-mansukh, for example, which we'll have a lecture also for it, maybe tomorrow, is the abrogation. The abrogating verses and the abrogated verses. And knowing that. So whenever you read an ayah, you would know by studying this specific science, not every ayah you can quote just because it has what you want. Not every ayah you can quote as a dalil. You have to know the reason of its revelation. Do we apply generally or not? Is this abrogated or is it an abrogating verse or it's not? This is another part of the sciences of the Quran. Also knowing the Makki and the Madani. Sometimes we just enjoy that when we look at the index of the Quran and say this surah Makki, this surah Madani, this surah. What does that mean? Have you asked yourself before, what does that mean? What does this mean? And what is the importance of it? Why should I know it? This is also we're going to cover today, inshallah. Knowing the numbering of the verses. Somebody said, what's the problem in knowing the number of the verses of the Quran or the number of a certain surah? Why you will find that in Surah Al-Anfal, for example, they tell you according to the Kufi it is 162, according to this it is 165. What does that mean? Means there was an ayah missing or an ayah extra? And where is the other three? If you say some people say 162 and some say 165, where is that? And this is a branch of the sciences of Quran as well. This is a specific science of Quran. It's called ilm al-rasmi wa add al-ayi. Yani the science of the script, studying the script of the Quran and the numbering of the ayat. Because one script, this is an ayah, one script, it is not an ayah. Two ayahs are one, or one ayah becomes two. We are not increasing any words or taking away any words, but that's very important. And to know the importance of Quran script, because this affects another thing, which is printing the Quran later on that we will cover, inshallah. So all this tells us one thing, that ulum al-Quran is not an easy thing just to, you know, take the credit or something like that. No, I want you to be studying today to one thing in your mind, to have one thing in your mind, that I want to be closer to the book of Allah. I want to enjoy the book of Allah. I want to understand the book of Allah. I want to implement and teach the book of Allah in a new manner, in a new way. So feel the responsibility and feel the importance of this beautiful, miraculous book of the Quran. So this is the general, as Sheikh Salah likes to say, a general look with the airplane to the project. Now we will take the definition of Ulum al-Quran and the history, means the evolution of Ulum al-Quran. How did it start? Was there something called Ulum al-Quran at the time of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, who said, today we study Ulum al-Quran like we are studying now? Or he will say, today is halaqat al-tafsir, and tomorrow is halaqat al-hadith, and after tomorrow is fiqh? Of course not. These are names came later on when this became an academic study, and we'll see why it came like this. The word or the topic here is Ulum al-Quran. This is a compound topic, Ulum and the Quran. Ulum and the Quran. Ulum is the plural of the word ilm. Ulum is the plural of the word ilm. And a branch of knowledge. right? Branch of knowledge. Ilm is branch of knowledge. Ulum is different branches of knowledge specific to something in relation to the life around you. We are not talking about the sciences of chemistry or physics or anything. We are talking purely from an Islamic point of view. So the ulum, the word ulum, when it is linguistically, it means a certain study following certain concepts to understand a specific subject. So it's a certain set of rules by which we understand a specific field or a specific subject. That is the ilm, that's a science. There are rules made over time. When applied, you understand certain things, right? So this can apply to everything. But when we come to the Islamic Sharia or Islam, when we say ulum, it is some certain rules by which if we apply, we understand what Allah wants from us. You apply that to fiqh. Ilm al-fiqh is studying, you know, the ibadat and the mu'amalat and all that. Ilm of tafsir, studying the tafsir of the Quran and the interpretation of that. Ilm al-nasikh wal-mansukh and abrogation and abrogated and all that. So whenever you add the word ilm to a certain field, it is the rules by which when applied you understand or you get more in depth of that specific branch. So the word ilm in Sharia, it is about knowing Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, knowing his signs and creations, knowing his action in his servants and creation. This is the word ilm. But if we come to become more academic, the branch that we are studying, the ulum al-Quran, what do they mean when they say the ulum al-Quran? What do they mean when they say ulum al-Quran? It means all those sciences that serve in Quran from different angles in order for us to connect more with the book of Allah and understand the wisdom behind its revelation. So this is what ulum al-Quran means. Ulum al-Quran means teaching you the rules in different aspects relating to the book of Allah. So when the Quran, when you approach the Quran, you approach it understanding it the way Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wants you to do. Right? So this is ulum al-Quran. But what is Quran? What is the Quran? If somebody asks you as a student in Sharia Academy, what is Quran? He wanted to define Quran. What is Quran? Anybody can volunteer? Go ahead. No, I'm not asking what the linguistic meaning. Not the linguistic meaning. No, and I want the Quran. Quran, Mus'haf, يعني. When you have the Quran, somebody tell you, what is that Quran? You tell him, here you go, this. I'm not talking linguistically. We understand linguistically, Quran means the text which is read over and over. That's linguistic, right? That's not what I'm asking you about. If someone as a Muslim, as you are a Muslim and someone who's not Muslim or a Muslim ask you, define Quran for me. But before you rush to the answer, you have to know one rule. You have to know one rule. Your definition has to be accurate, has to be exclusive of certain things and inclusive of certain things, right? So that those conditions has to be there. So your definition has to be precise and accurate. It has to be done in such a way that encompasses all what's supposed to be encompassed and exclude anything that is not supposed to be included in that definition. With that, I repeat the question again. So now who can define what is Quran? Tafaddal.
The word of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, through Jibril alayhi salam, and protection is guaranteed.
MashaAllah. Yeah, almost. Almost. this is a very good, yani very close. The closest to the definition, MashaAllah. But the Quran, I'll read it in Arabic and I will say it in English as well. Huwa kalamullahi. That's the first important word, yani. Kalamullahi. It is the kalam of Allah, and we'll have that topic discussed because it is very important. Huwa kalamullahi al-mu'jiz. Kalamullahi al-mu'jiz. Mu'jiz means miraculous, means it's challenging. It's challenging. Yani no one can bring anything like it. Kalamullahi al-mu'jiz al-munazzalu ala Muhammadin sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And the word munazzal is important, which descended to Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Al-maktubu fil masahif, which is written in the mushaf. Al-manqulu bit tawatur. Yani it is coming to us from a larger group, from a larger group, from a larger group. Al-muta'abbadu bitilawatih. Yani that we worship Allah with reciting it. And in English, in English, one of the most accurate definitions, which is this exactly what I just mentioned, the Quran is the Arabic speech. You cannot say the speech, no, the Arabic speech, because this is very important. When you say Arabic speech, what did it exclude now? Any other language, right? It is the Arabic kalam or speech of Allah. What does that definition mean now? The Arabic kalam of Allah. Does that mean Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala have kalam but not in Arabic? Yes. Allah revealed the Torah not in Arabic. Allah revealed the Injil not in Arabic. Allah revealed the different books not in Arabic. So Imam al-Darimi, rahimahullah, one of the scholars who collected the Sunan, he said, Allah can speak in any language he wants. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala can speak in any language he wants, not necessarily Arabic. Because Allah says in the Quran, our Quran, يعني Allah says, وَمَا أَرْسَلْنَا مِنْ رَسُولٍ إِلَّا بِلِسَانِ قَوْمِهِ لِيُبَيْنَ لَهُمْ. We have not sent a messenger except with the tongue or the language of his people, so he can make it clear for them. So the Prophet is speaking a language. Why Allah would reveal to him the Torah in Arabic? يعني nobody speaks Arabic. Okay? So here, the definition of Quran, each and every word and letter of that definition exclude many things. كَلَامُ اللَّهِ, يعني the Arabic kalam of Allah. So the Arabic kalam of anybody else is also. See how every word, you know, with a definition, that's how it become tight. Kalam. So anything other than kalam, it is not included in the Quran. Actions or what not. Kalam. Kalamu Allah. يعني of Allah, not of Rasulullah صلى الله عليه وسلم, not of Jibreel عليه السلام, not of anybody else. باللغة العربية, Arabic. It means not in any other language, not any other language, which he revealed to Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So it excludes what here? Anything that Allah revealed other than Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. In wordings and in meanings. Pay attention to this because it has an aqidah issue in it. And many sects deviated in this one. With meaning and wordings. That the utterance that come out, it is from Allah. Because some group will say, Quran is revealed to Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam by meaning only. Why they say that? Why they say this? Because their aqidah that Allah does not have the sifa of kalam. Allah does not talk. Because if you say Allah talk, that means talking needs a tongue, needs a mouth, needs a sound. And when you attribute this to Allah, you're making him resemble the human being. But they forget the basic simple fact that لَيْسَ كَمِثْلِهِ شَيْءٍ. Nothing is like Allah. Are you alive or dead? Now if I ask you, are you alive or dead? Life. Is Allah alive or dead? Can you say that the life of Allah exactly like my life? Then, once this is done, Allah hears but not like us. Allah sees but not like us. Allah sits but not like us. Allah happy but not like us. Allah laughs but not like us. Okay? This is the simplest way of understanding things. Why it is so big of a problem, subhanAllah. Allah does and says whatever he said that he does and do. Not necessarily like any of his creation. Subhanahu wa ta'ala. So kalamullah, this is the Arabic speech of Allah revealed to his prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. By meaning or in words, in wordings and meanings. Because some would say that Allah put the Quran in Al-Lawh al-Mahfuz, as we'll see in a minute. You know, Al-Lawh al-Mahfuz, the original tablet of all the things. Allah created the pen and then created Al-Lawh al-Mahfuz and told the pen to write everything which is going to be until the Day of Judgment, right? Write everything. So, Quran is in there. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala all told Jibreel alayhi salam, so Jibreel alayhi salam go take the verses that he wants and go say to Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. That is one problem, right? We'll talk about it. The other problem is that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gave it to Jibreel in a way different than talking. Yani Jibreel did not hear it. It is just given to him somehow by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And then Jibreel alayhi salam expressed it to Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So it is the talking of Jibreel. Taban, this is very bad. And the others would say, even Jibreel alayhi salam gave it to Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam in a different way, and Rasulullah expressed with his human language. That's even worse. This would apply to the Sunnah, yeah, to the Hadith al-Nabawi. This would be applicable to the Hadith al-Nabawi that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gave the inspiration to Rasulullah. Jibreel alayhi salam gave Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam the inspiration or the idea, and Rasulullah expressed it in his Arabic human wordings, that anybody can make anything like it. So that's why Hadith al-Nabawi, it is not miraculous in its speech, but Quran is. So if it is not the words of Allah, so what is so miraculous about it though? Right? So it's mu'jiz. So in wordings and in meaning. And which has been preserved in the Musahif. That is a very essential part of the definition, by the way. You may take it lightly. Why we say it has been preserved in the Musahif? Musahif of Uthman, radiallahu anhu. This is very important to know when we say the word Musahif. It is not the Mus'haf يعني, that you have in your masjid or anything like that. No, the Mus'haf is the original copies that Uthman ibn Affan radiallahu anhu sent to everybody to copy from. And we do so until our time now. So this Quran is the one that preserved in the Mus'haf, that it is preserved in the Mus'haf and was written at the time of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. That's where Uthman got it, and that's where everybody else copied it later on. And has reached us by mutawatir transmissions. By mutawatir transmissions. Because there are certain recitations of Quran and the scripts of Quran that we will study in when we come to the different styles of recitation and all that. But it's not mutawatir. Yani it is one person only narrating it. It's not a group of people. Yani one person, he heard it from a sahabi like Abdullah ibn Mas'ud, for example. Then he started reciting with it. And nobody learned it from him except one person. And then except one person. This, we do not read Quran in that style. It may be used in the tafsir, for example. But we cannot read with it. You are not rewarded if you read with it. Actually, you will be punished if you read with it. You know, sometimes. So, it is the recitation which is preserved in the masahif and reached us by the mutawatir transmissions. That's why the 10 qira'at now, we have 10 qira'at. All of them mutawatir. Yani group from a group, from a group, from a group, till the Sahaba, and there was a group doing it as well, from Ar-Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. That's called mutawatir. So when somebody tell you how many qira'at are there, تقول عشرة, 10, mutawatira. Anything other than those 10, they are not mutawatir. It does not mean they are bad though, okay? We will come to that. When we come to the qira'at tomorrow, inshallah, very fun, interesting lecture, I promise. Because, alhamdulillah, this is my specialty, right? So it will be very nice. So this qira'at mutawatira. Qira'at al-ashara al-mutawatira. 7 plus 3, and we'll say what is 7 and what is 3, inshallah, and all that. Other than those 10 that exist now, it's called qira'at shadha. What is it called? Qira'at shadha means it is not mutawatir. The word shadh can be something good, can be something bad. Shadh means it is not following the norm. Right? That's why when they say, as a human being, this person is shadh, means he's not following the norm. Not following the norm of people. Right? Of gender and of things, they're not following the norm that everybody is, like a family. Shadh. In certain shadh means, you know what I mean, right? Shadh means he's out of the rule. Yeah. So when you say qira'a shadha, means it is not following the norm, the rules. It is written in Mus'haf Usman. It is coming from, you know, mutawatir, group from group. That's why they call it shadha. Some of the shadha is to be recited, to be used in the tafsir and to understand the rulings and all that. And some of it, we don't use it at all because it is different from the Arabic rulings as well. So I repeat the definition again. It is the speech, the Arabic speech of Allah, which he revealed to Rasulullah Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam in wordings and in meanings, and which has been preserved in Mus'hafs, and has reached us by mutawatir transmissions and is a challenge to mankind to produce something similar to it. That's the last portion of the definition, and a challenge. Anybody remember that where that challenge came in the Quran? You don't have to mention the surah and the verse number, but do you know that there is a challenge made in the Quran for somebody to bring something like it? Yes or no?
Yes.
And that's a miracle of the Quran itself. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala challenged. He said, فَلْيَأْتُوا بِمِثْلِهِ فَلْيَأْتُوا. Repeat the Arabic word with me, يعني. So this you become familiar with it, because we'll see lots of Arabic words today. فَلْيَأْتُوا بِمِثْلِهِ بِمِثْلِهِ. مِثْلِهِ means the like of it, means similar to it in its entirety. You say that this Quran Muhammad wrote, please go ahead, تفضل. Bring me something like that. So you people say poetry, you are more eloquent than this man, you're claiming that this is his production, go ahead. He cannot. قُلْ لَإِنِ اجْتَمَعَتِ الْإِنسُ وَالْجِنُّ عَلَىٰ أَنْ يَأْتُوا بِمِثْلِ هَذَا الْقُرْآنِ لَا يَأْتُونَ بِمِثْلِهِ وَلَوْ كَانَ بَعْضُهُمْ لِبَعْضٍ ظَهِيرًا. If the jinn and ins, so about jinn and ins, from the beginning of jinn until يوم القيامة, humans from Adam till يوم القيامة, if they to be gathered together to produce something like this Quran, they will not be able to. Someone prove it wrong, يا جماعة. And this is the miracle of the Quran. This is what it meant here. يعني Quran telling you a challenge and you are not accepting the challenge even though you are the enemy of the Quran. يعني you wish to prove that Quran is not the word of Allah, and here Allah is posing a challenge for you and he did not do it. What does that mean in itself? That will make you also understand when an Orientalist person comes and say this Quran is the word of Muhammad. Right? And we tell him, yes, it is not the words of Muhammad, neither it is the words of Muhammad. Yani it is neither Muhammad nor Muhammad, right? It is not the words of anybody. It is the words of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So let them know. And how can you prove? If the Arabs themselves couldn't do it. Yani Arabs themselves, Abu Jahl, you think Abu Jahl would waste a chance. And by the way, Abu Jahl was not an ignorant guy. يعني. Was not an ignorant person who does not know how to read and write. No, he was a very eloquent person. Very eloquent person. These people, their main characteristic or their main attribute, that al-fasaha. Fasaha in Arabic means eloquent. Yani they are orators, they are poets, they are people who are, you know, this is their thing. And they could not do it. And you come in the 20th century and say, you know, this Quran is not a word of God. What? Yani the people who are with enemies, they couldn't prove it and they didn't challenge, right? So for someone to come later on, either you challenge or not. Then the challenge was reduced. You cannot bring total. قُلْ فَأْتُوا بِعَشْرِ سُورٍ مِثْلِهِ مُفْتَرَيَاتٍ أَمْ يَقُولُونَ افْتَرَاهُ. Surah Hud. أَمْ يَقُولُونَ افْتَرَاهُ. They said that he made it up. Okay. Start like him. He iftara 114 surahs, you bring me 10. And the shortest ones, no problem. فَأْتُوا بِعَشْرِ سُورٍ مِثْلِهِ مُفْتَرَيَاتٍ. Challenge also is not met. Then Allah reduces the challenge again. And he said, فَأْتُوا بِسُورَةٍ. قُلْ فَأْتُوا بِسُورَةٍ. يعني إِنَّ أَعْطَنَاكَ الْكَوْثَرِ فَصَلِّ لِرَبِّكَ وَانْحَرْ إِنَّ شَنَاكَ وَالْأَفْضَرِ. Or وَالْعَصْرِ إِنَّ الْإِنسَانَ لَفِي خُسْرٍ إِلَّا الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا. See how smooth and easy it's coming out from my mouth? Make something like that. Musayyam al-Kadhab, when he tried to make Quran, so someone goes to him and they said, Ya Musayyam, from his tribe, Banu Hanifa, Ya Musayyam, tell me who comes to you in the day or the night? Yani this angel guy comes to you. His day or night. He said, he comes at night and I don't see him. He said, okay, recite to me some of your Quran. And he starts speaking like gibberish, you know. You know, وَالْخَبِزَاتِ خَبْزَ وَالطَّحِنَاتِ طَحْنَ فَالْأَكِلَاتِ أَكْلَ وَالْحَجَدْ دِكِنَ. Something like that. Like he's trying to imitate وَالذَّرِيَاتِ ذَرْوَ فَالْحَامِلَاتِ وِقْرَ فَالْجَارِيَاتِ يُسْرَ إِنَّمَا تُوَعَدُونَ لَوْ صَادِقٍ وَإِنَّ الدِّينَ لَوَاقِعٍ. Beautiful ayat of Allah. So he goes to say, وَالذَّارِيَاتِ ذَرُوَ. Same thing, right? Then, وَالْحَاصِدَاتِ حَصْدَى فَالطَّاحِنَاتِ طَحْنَى وَالْعَجِنَاتِ عَجْنَى فَالْخَبْزَاتِ خَبْزَى فَالْأَكِلَاتِ أَكْلَى. Ya salam. Yani when the seed is planted, and then when the seed is grind, and then when it is made a dough, and then when it is baked, and then when it is eaten. He think he made a Quran. So the guy, he laughed at him. Yani he's coming to follow. He laughed at him. He said, Wallahi inni a'lamu annaka lakadhab. By Allah, and I know that you are an imposter and you are a liar. Wa a'lamu anna Muhammadan sadiqun rasulullah. Yani I know that Muhammad sadiq rasulullah. But kadhabu al-yamama khayrun li min sadiq mudar. Yani a liar from my tribe is better than a truthful person from Quraysh. See? So even those who did not follow Islam knew that these are not the words of humans. And all of you, I'm sure, know the story. When in Mecca, Abu Jahl, Abu Sufyan, and Walid ibn al-Mughira, I think, they go and they listen to Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam at night while he's reciting, behind each other's backs. And they yajma'uhum al-tariq. They are leaving before the Fajr. Oh, let's go home before anybody can discover me. They bump into each other. What are you doing here? What are you doing here? What are you doing here? We all know what we're doing here. So please, let's promise each other that we're not going to come again. They go, and next day, they do the same thing. And the third day, they do the same thing. Subhanallah al-Azim. Yani that tells you what? They were affected. What was preventing them from Islam, though? Huh? Ah. The arrogance and ego. And the same thing prevent us also from learning sometimes. I feel bigger than that subject, right? I feel I'm going to sit with a kid. I'm going to make mistakes now after all this gray hair and stuff. Same thing. But yeah, different. We are not the same, but it is there, right?